See, the sense I'm getting is that most of you are either BTech, BSc. Some of you are from BCom and BA. Isn't that right? And within this BA, BCom crowd also, I don't think any one of you have any acquaintance with this discipline called sociology. Am I right? All of you are like fresh slates and you have come here to learn something about sociology, right? One thing. Let me just speak for 10 minutes and please pay attention. This is very important. The aim of this course, right? We are going to spend about 16 weeks with each other, right? And the aim of this course is not to turn all of you into sociologists, okay? You don't have to become a sociologist to get high marks in your UPSC civil services examination, right? My aim is not to turn all of you into sociologists, right? Now see, our aim is to get this. We must all aim to get something like 300 plus marks in our mains examination, optional papers, right? Out of 500, right? So you have a 500 mark paper, that is 250 marks in paper 1 and 250 marks in paper 2, right? And our aim is this. Our aim is to get 300 plus score. Okay, this is why we are all here. First of all, get this in your minds clearly. Our aim is not to become sociologists. This is not our aim, right? We are here to do certain types of things, to learn certain types of concepts, and to develop certain types of skills so that you are well positioned to get this 300 plus score in your mains examination, right? I am not here to turn you into sociologists. Why do I say this? Because the syllabus that is prescribed by UPSC for sociology optional, this is BA honors level syllabus, BA honors level syllabus, and particularly the type of syllabus that is prescribed in the Delhi University. All right? This is the syllabus of your examination. And this BA honors course is taught in 3 years. Right? Now they've made it into 4 years in Delhi University, but generally, traditionally, this BA honors course is taught in 3 years. Our syllabus includes something more than this BA honors as well, okay? So let us call it BA honors plus. There are certain a few topics which are not taught in BA honors, but we have to learn as part of our sociology preparation. Excuse me. Now, you may understand here that I am trying to condense what is taught in 3+ years. Right. As I was saying, my job is quite difficult because I have to condense whatever is taught in these 3 years and teach you this in 16 weeks. Okay, now you can imagine what kind of a task this is, right? So I have to teach you what is taught in 3 years in 16 weeks. Okay. Also, on the flip side, you have to learn what is generally learnt in 3 years in 16 weeks. Okay. So we have first of all, take the task very seriously. These 16 weeks are important. Let's get that in your heads first of all. Right. Please be very serious in these 16 weeks. Right. Because if we are condensing this 3 year syllabus into 16 weeks and I'm delivering that content to you and you are making an attempt to learn this content, I hope you understand the sort of seriousness that you have to exhibit in this course, right? So it's very, very important. Very, very important that all of you are serious. Now, since we've said that to get this 300 plus score is our aim, what is it that we have to do? Don't be under the impression that at the end of 16 weeks, you will have everything to get this 300 plus score. No. Okay. it's not the case that at the end of 16 weeks you'll have all the skills, all the content and the temperament to get this score. No, you won't have it. All right. To get this 300 plus score, it's like a journey, right? It's like a journey. And the first stage of this journey is what is called as the foundation course, which is where we are all right now. This is what is called the sociology foundation course. All right. After this sociology foundation course, there comes a stage which I call revision stage. Or let us call it the first revision stage. Okay. Then after this first revision stage comes a point which is called content enhancement phase. Content enhancement phase. Then comes the writing phase. Okay, these are the four steps. You have to finish these four steps at least 2 to 3 months before your prelims examination. Okay, so most of you all might be writing your prelims examination sometime in July, right? July 2022. So you have to finish this by something like March. By March 2022, you have to finish these four stages. Right. So if we count 16 weeks from now, it'll be around January, right? Okay. So you'll have February and March, 2 months to finish these three phases. Now, what are these phases? Let me explain this to you. In this foundation course, all of you start as clean slates, that you don't know anything about sociology as a discipline. You start here and you get foundational content on all the topics, foundational content and understanding. Foundational content and understanding of all the topics that are mentioned in your syllabus. All the topics that are mentioned in your syllabus, right? But generally, the experience is that at the end of 4 weeks, after you're done learning about all the concepts, if I simply quiz you about something that is taught in the first week of the course, none of you will be able to recall. None of you will be able to recall anything that has happened in the first week of the course at the end of 16 weeks. Right? It's a sorry position to be in, but that happens. Right? So what you would do is that immediately after your foundation course is over, you will spend about 2 weeks to intensively revise what has been done in your foundation course. To intensively revise what has been done in your foundation course. Okay, to the extent that if I ask you about any random topic from the syllabus, you will be able to at least tell me 4 or 5 points about that topic. In your own language, you are able to tell me that, yes, sir, this topic is related to this thinker. This is what it means. These are the advantages of this concept. These are the disadvantages of this concept, like this. Okay. So in these 2 weeks, you will do the first intensive revision. And by that time, all of you are somewhat refreshing your memory about what you have learned in the previous 16 weeks. Then comes the phase of content enhancement. That is, you will spend one full month to enhance your content. Now, what is this content enhancement, right? As we go along in this course, I will tell you how to enhance your content, right? So you will take your notes and you will start adding more and more content to it. Okay, some place you can also call it value addition. Now, what is the nature of this value addition? For example, I teach you a topic called suicide, right? This is what we are going to discuss under the thinker Emil Durkheim, right? Suicide, right? I will explain this topic to you. right? Then you will ask certain number of questions about this topic to enhance your content. Can I apply this to Indian situation? Can I apply this to Indian situation? Something that I am seeing generally around myself, can I apply this to the Indian situation or not? All right. Then you will also ask the question, are there some current affairs that I have come across recently which correlate with this topic? Which correlate with this topic? Okay. You will also ask yourself, how can I write a good example? Okay. The word I give is illustration. How can I illustrate this study? How can I give a good illustration of this study? You will ask yourself these types of questions. I'll tell you exactly how to do this as we go along. But you will ask yourselves these types of questions and you will spend 1 month to write something new, novel about the topics that I have taught you in the foundation course. And this you have to do by yourself. I will teach you the way to do it. That skill I will try to impart to you. Okay, because the more fresh, novel and new your content, the greater the possibility that you will score very high marks in your final examination, right? If you simply reproduce this static content that I am going to teach you in the foundation course, you will end up with average score. That is around 250, 260, this range. But that is not sufficient to get you a rank. To get a rank, you have to do this. And this 1 month is going to be a make or break time in your optional preparation. Okay. So if we take 2 weeks here, this will be from mid-February to mid-March. Isn't it? Mid-February to mid-March. Then you will start writing. Until then, it does not make any sense to write. Okay. It does not mean that you will not learn how to write. Okay. We will start learning how to write simultaneously. All right. As we go about in this foundation course, there are three deliverables in this foundation course. In this 16 weeks, there are three deliverables. Okay. One is content. Okay. All the content, theoretical content, sociological content relating to all the topics that are mentioned in your syllabus. First deliverable. Second deliverable is that I will teach you how to do content enhancement. Okay. Value addition, the skill of value addition. I'm writing VA skill. Value addition skill. Second deliverable. The third deliverable is answer structuring. I'm not saying answer writing. Answer structuring. That is, given that you have content and you have also added value, how are you going to present this in a suitable manner in your examination within the time and space constraints? All right. These are the three things that I will deliver to you in this foundation course. Then you will revise. Then you will do your own content enhancement. After that, we will think about a test series or writing practice or the way to go. Clear? Is this making sense to everyone? You can take this down actually in the very first page of your notes, so that you can remind yourself that this is what I'm supposed to do going forward. Okay, I'm looking at the chat box. Online students, are you all able to see the board clearly? If you have any questions, please type it out in the chat box. I'll be opening this chat box in once in, say, 15 minutes or 20 minutes. Okay, right. Now, next thing, what are some good practices that you have to follow so that you are able to make the most out of this course, right? Let us also go through that once. Certain good practices that you have to follow. First is regarding notes, right? How are you going to take your notes? See, the way I'm going to do it is that in the first one or two chapters, I'm going to dictate notes to you. Okay. Why am I doing that? So that you get into the habit of writing in a particular way. All right. After that, depending upon the context, right, I will be sending you scanned copies of handwritten notes. you are expected to look at the scanned copies of handwritten notes and copy down the same thing in your notes. Now, what some students do is that, anyway, sir has sent me handwritten notes. Let me just print it out and put it in a folder, right? Please don't do that. Okay. So the first good practice that you have to do is own handwritten notes. Okay. Now, the way you are going to do this is that suppose there is a page like this, and I'm teaching you a topic called social facts. Okay. This is a topic that is there in the syllabus. Chalo, I'm giving you all the notes. You are writing down, Okay. This is over. Then leave at least two pages after every concept. Okay. Because you will understand that it will save you a lot of time when you are doing your content enhancement. Leave at least two pages after every topic so that when you are doing your content enhancement, you know where to write what. Okay. This is very important. Okay. This is one thing. Then second one is that revise every day. Right. So for example, we are going to have classes from Monday to Friday from 2 to 4, right? So if I teach you something on Monday, go back home and spend at least 45 minutes revising what I have taught you and come to the class the next day, right? Do that. And over the weekend, that is Saturday and Sunday, you'll revise whatever has been taught in the entire week once. All right. This is the second good practice that you have to do. Third one is keep looking at previous year's questions. How will you look at this? All of you buy New Vishal publications. Okay. What is called sociology topic wise booklet. All right. Now this booklet contains all the questions that are asked in the previous years. All right. And this is organized according to subtopics within a topic. Right. So for example, under Emil Durkheim, there is Emil Durkheim is one topic. And in chapter 4, there is one thinker called Emil Durkheim. Right. So social facts is one of his theories or concepts. Okay. Now what they do is that they give you Emil Durkheim and they give you all the questions that have been asked in the last 30, 40 years. Suppose if I teach you this topic, go back home and look at what type of questions have been asked on this particular concept, social fact. Okay. And ask yourselves, based on what I have understood in the classroom and based on the notes that I already have, am I in a position to write at least 150 to 200 words on this topic or not? You have to do this every day, right? So 45 minutes of revision and 15 minutes of looking at previous year's questions. Okay. So you'll spend 2 hours here in the classroom and 1 hour at home. Okay. This is what you're supposed to do. Okay. So keep looking at previous year's questions, right? Then also look at previous toppers' answer copies. If you go on the internet, you can find answer copies of the test series that toppers from previous years have written at various institutes. Okay. Now, suppose if I have taught you this topic, social facts, right? What have you done? You have asked yourself whether you are able to write some content or the other from previous year's questions. When you go through these toppers copies, you may stumble upon some question related to social fact and they have written an answer. Okay. Look at what they have written. Okay. So that you have an idea as to what type of content you are supposed to write to become a topper yourself. Right. This is the only way that you can train your mind and train yourself to get high marks in optional subjects. Look at what they have written. Okay. So please understand that most of these toppers have no particular academic training in sociology. They are all students like you. They've done BCom, BAC, BTech, whatever they have done. All right. they have spent about 1 year's time studying sociology and they are able to write that content. Okay. So if you start doing it from day one onwards, you will have an idea as to where your destination is, to what, at what level are you supposed to write to get topper type marks. Okay. So please start looking at previous topper's copies. Right. So these are some of the good practices and please follow them religiously. See, my experience is that I've been teaching for a number of years now. In the first 1 or 2 weeks, all of you have enthusiasm. Okay. You're all doing it, right? You, at least you're attempting to do something. And slowly this enthusiasm keeps waning. And by the time you reach the 10th week or something, all of you are like dead vegetables. Okay. Sitting in this class. Okay. You're just staring into the abyss. You're not able to follow anything and you have grown confused. Why have you grown confused and disinterested? Because you have not been religiously doing this every day. If you don't revise, if you don't, you know, keep looking at previous year's questions, and if you don't keep practicing, then you will lose track somewhere. Because as I already told you, I'm going to deliver a lot of content, which is supposed to be delivered in 3 years in only 16 weeks. Right? So please be serious and please do these things religiously. Please do these things very, very religiously. Okay. Just one more thing. Please be on time. Okay. Please be on time to the class. Okay. By around 2:05, we'll start the class by 2:05. Okay. So please be on time to the class so that we don't lose any time. Right. Are there any questions from your end? I'm happy to answer now. Any questions concerning how to start preparation? Oh, yes. What books to buy, right? Buy Harlambos and Holborn blue color book. That's enough. Don't waste your money and go around buying a lot of books that you will never read. Okay. I'll write the spelling here. The book is called, it's written by these authors. Okay. Go to any UPSC bookstore and ask for this. Harlambos and Holborn. Okay, this is a blue color book. It has a blue cover because there is also one red color book written by the same author. Okay, orange color. Okay, it's Harlambos and Holborn. Okay, blue color book. Okay, it's a fat book. You don't have to read the entire book. Okay, I'll tell you what pages to read from that book. But keep this book ready. Keep this book ready. How many of you all have already bought this book? Okay, many of you have. Some of you have. Okay, great. Good job. Okay, get this book and keep it ready. Okay, I'll tell you the page numbers and what to read from this book and you will go back and read. Okay, so other than all of this, suppose if I teach you a topic. Right. Say there is a topic called social stratification. I teach you this topic and that topic is covered very well in this book. I'll tell you when that happens. Please go back home and use the weekend to read from the original text. Why? Why do I say this? Because when you read from the original text, you develop the art of writing in sociological language. All right. It's very, very important. Okay. The art of writing in sociological language is very, very important. So please try to read. Whenever I ask you to read something from the original text, please make an attempt to read. Okay. Sometimes you may follow, sometimes you may not follow, but at least make an attempt so that you understand how to write. Okay. Right. Any questions from your end? Please ask me. Any questions concerning how to start, what to do before I start explaining to you the syllabus? Yes. Any question? No need. Completely ignore NCERT books. Okay. No need NCERT books. Yes. Any other question? I'm sorry, I can't follow your question.
So we have to focus on the paper wise or the what you went to talk in that class.
I am going to teach paper wise only. Okay. So just follow the sequence that I am following. Okay. because particularly in your paper two, the topics are all mixed up. All right. That is, the theme is related to rural sociology, for example. So one topic is in second chapter, one topic is in fifth chapter, like this. I'm going to club all these topics thematically and teach you, right? So just follow the sequence that I am following and it will make sense to you, right? Anything else? Nitin Sangwan, okay, don't waste your money, okay? That's for later stage. When you do that third step, no content enhancement, then maybe you can get that book and see whether I can write one or two more points from that book. But otherwise, that book is nothing but copy paste of coaching material that is found outside in the market. Okay. It has no special content. Yes. Anything else? Yeah. No, it won't be, because you will be learning how to structure your answers from now itself. When I say answer writing, it means that you have finished with your content part. Okay. Answer writing has two words. No, one is answer. You have to know the answer and then write it. First, know the answer. Okay. Then you will start writing. Okay. But how to write, we will start learning simultaneously. Okay. I'll give you a framework to structure your answers. You'll try to follow that framework and you'll also practice. And you're also going to look at previous toppers' copies, right? So you're simultaneously developing a skill or an awareness as to how should a good answer look, right? That is the idea. Anybody? Any other question? No? Okay. Let me just see what's happening here in the chat box. If there are any questions, online students, if there are any questions, please immediately type it out in the chat box, right? I'll just look at those questions and answer them for you, right? Okay, now let us start with understanding our syllabus, right? How many of you were in my workshop? Okay, I asked you to find out, I asked you to do some things. How many of you have done it? Anyone has done it? You have done it? You've tried to do it? Yes. What did you find out, sir? Any new thing that you have found out? Huh? To Google, right? What did you find out? Any interesting thing that you have found out that you did not know previously? Okay. Have you found out what is modernity? Yeah, but what is the meaning of the word modernity? Did you find out? Enlightenment. Okay. Another word he found out, enlightenment. Okay. Anybody else have found out what is modernity? Those who were in my workshop a few days back. Yes, ma'am. You? You haven't found out. Louder. Enhancement. Okay. Renaissance. One more word. Okay. Sorry? Transition phase. Okay. Good word. Good. Okay. Yes. So we'll look at the syllabus and I'll tell you, please take this down. All right. This is like a kind of a checklist. Do I know about this or not? You have to ask yourselves these things. Okay. Okay. The first topic is sociology, the discipline. Okay. This is the first chapter. In this, the first topic is modernity and social changes in Europe and emergence of sociology. Okay, modernity and social changes in Europe. Modernity and social changes in Europe and emergence of sociology. Emergence of sociology, right? This is the topic. Now, this topic deals with the birth of sociology, okay? This topic deals with the birth of this discipline called sociology, right? So here you have to learn about certain things. Please take these down, right? And ask yourselves at the end of the course, have I learned it or not, okay? First, you have to learn about what is called Renaissance. Okay, then you have to learn about what is called Reformation. You have to learn about what is called the Scientific Revolution. Scientific Revolution. You have to learn about what is called Enlightenment. Then you have to learn about what is called Industrial Revolution. Okay, you have to learn about what is called French Revolution. Then ultimately, you have to also appreciate the concept of modernity. The concept of modernity, right? Then you have to also understand reactions to modernity. Reactions to modernity. Okay. Then finally, you have to understand emergence of sociology as a product of modernity. Emergence of sociology as a product of modernity. ठीक है. Okay. See, I'll just give you a brief idea. See, something happened in Europe. All right. That is between 15th century to 18th century. Between this time. Some great changes took place in Europe, right? And these great changes are sometimes referred to as the great transformation of Europe. That is, the European society, its culture, the way people thought, all these things underwent a dramatic change in a period of 300 to 400 years, right? And this led to what is called the transition from a traditional society to a modern society. Okay, modernity is nothing but this new society that has been inaugurated in Europe from the 18th century onwards. That is what is called as a modern society, right? And sociology as a discipline is a product of this transition from traditional society to modern society. How did this happen? This is the theme of this paper, this topic. Okay, clear? Yes. Next one is scope of the subject. Write down second one. Scope of the subject. Scope of the subject and comparison with other social science disciplines. Sorry. Scope of the subject and comparison with other social science disciplines. Social sciences disciplines. Okay. So what is the idea here? What do you mean by scope? What do you mean by scope? Very good. Okay. What are the boundaries of this discipline? Okay. So say something like the dynamics of your gastrointestinal system is not in the scope of physics. You say that, right? The scope of physics is something else. What does this discipline study? Okay, this is what is there in this topic. So in this, you will write up, you will study about what is called the synthetic formalist debate. the synthetic formalist debate. Okay, then you will learn about what is called the sociological imagination. You will also learn about what is called reflexive sociology. You will learn what is called reflexive sociology. Then, in the next part of this topic, you will learn about the comparison between sociology and certain other social science disciplines, that is economics, history, political science, psychology, and philosophy. Okay, what do I mean by comparison? It means how sociology is different from these disciplines and what sociology can learn from these disciplines. Okay, so this involves both differences and interaction also. Differences and interaction between these disciplines and sociology as a discipline. Right? Clear? Then the next one is called sociology and common sense, but actually you can write it down here itself, okay? Or your wish, okay? Next topic is sociology and common sense. Okay, sociology and common sense, right? Here we are going to discuss the interaction or let us say the difference between sociology and common sense, and we are going to look at the perspectives, two perspectives. Okay, one is positivist perspective. Positivist perspective, is there a problem? And what is called the interactionist perspective? Interactionist perspective. Okay, positivist perspective and the interact. Don't get confused. Okay, anybody found out what is positivism? Did anyone Google positivism? You Google? Yeah, what did you find out? Good. Okay, not exactly correct, but at least you have made an effort. Okay, somewhat correct. Okay. We'll look at positivist perspective and we'll look at interactionist perspective, right? And here the focus is on comparing sociology with common sense. Okay, sociology with common sense, right? Why do we discuss this? Because sociologists study topics which appear as if everybody has some idea about these topics. For example, if sociologists focus on family, right? All of you live in families and you know something about family, and you may be questioning yourself, what is it that a sociologist has to teach me about family? I have a family, I know about family, right? Okay, but no, sociologists have something to teach you about family. So that is why we speak about the difference between sociology and common sense. How are these two different? All right, so this is what is there in your entirety of first chapter. Okay, now second chapter is called sociology as science. Second chapter is called sociology as science. Second chapter is called sociology as science. Yes, the first one is, in this, we'll first look at what is science. What is scientific method? Many of us have used this word scientific method, but very few of us have a clear understanding of what it really means. Okay, so we'll understand what is science, what is scientific method, and we will criticize scientific method. Okay, we'll provide a critique of scientific method. We'll provide a critique of scientific method. What goes under the name of science may not always be valid. All right. It may have many types of, it may be incomplete. And science may not be able to answer several types of questions. For example, there are ethical and moral questions. Can science ever answer an ethical and moral question? No, it cannot. Right. So the focus here mainly is to understand science so that we start asking ourselves, can we use a scientific method to understand society? We can use scientific method to understand, say, for example, the behavior of electrons. But can we use scientific method to understand the behavior of individuals, human beings? Can we or cannot we? That is the type of debate that we are going to raise here, right? Then there's a next topic that is called major theoretical strands in research methodology. Okay, in this, so I'm just writing major strands in research methodology. Is there a problem? Did someone call me? No. Major strands in research methodology, right? Under this topic, we are going to look at three types of arguments. One is what is called positivism. The second one is what is called interpretativism. And the third one is what is called critical sociology. The third one is what is called critical social. Are you not able to see? You can come sit here if you are unable to see. Okay. Okay. Positivism, interpretativism, and critical sociology. Right. Now, what is it that we are looking at here? See, this research methodology is all about asking what is the right way to study society? What is the right way? To study society. There are three types of answers here. That is what we are going to discuss. What is the right way to study society? All right. This is what this research methodology essentially deals with. And here we are going to look at three types of answers to this question. Okay. The positivist answer, the interpretativist answer, and the critical sociology's answer, right? Then we have a topic called positivism and its critique. Okay, I'm going to do it as part of this one itself. Okay, what is positivism? What are its advantages? What are its disadvantages? Then we are going to look at this topic called fact, value, and objectivity. Okay. This is the topic, fact, value, and objectivity. All right. See, we discuss this topic in sociology because, say, for example, I am weighing the molecular mass of, say, some element. All right. Whether I weigh it or whether you weigh it, whether I weigh it here in India or some other country, the weight will not change. Okay. Or if I perform some complex mathematical operation, irrespective of who is performing this operation, the result will be the same. These types of results are called objective results. These types of results are called objective results. But when you study society, this type of objectivity is very, very difficult to achieve. Right? Very, very difficult to achieve. Say, for example, I'm studying this society in Domalgoda. We are in this place called Domalgoda. Right? Suppose I come to some conclusions. I focus on certain types of aspects. Right? But tomorrow, a feminist scholar comes and studies the same society. Okay? She has a different perspective on how society is. The way she looks at the society would be completely different. Feminists can be men also. He or she can look at the society would be completely different. Right? So if there is a family, there is a man and there is a woman, and the man goes out to work, the woman stays at home and takes care of children. One person may describe this as teamwork. There may be a person who may look at this and describe it as a teamwork. But another person may come and describe this as sexual division of labor and oppression of women. All right. So depending on who is looking at the society and in what way you are looking at the society, your conclusions start differing in sociology. All right. So we are going to describe, or we are going to debate, what is the problem of these facts, values, and objectivity in sociology as a discipline. That is the theme of this topic, right? Yes. Then we have what is called as non-positivist methodologies. Non-positivist methodologies. Okay, here we are going to focus mainly on three types of non-positivist methodologies. One is what is called symbolic interactionism. The second one is what is called phenomenology. The third one is what is called ethnomethodology. These are the three types of theories that we are going to discuss here under this topic, right? Now, what is this positivist methodology and non-positivist methodology? So this is positivism, right? So these two will be non-positivist methodologies. All right. So positivism, just understand this. It is the idea that whatever methods that you use in natural sciences, okay, same types of methods and approach can also be used in social sciences. Okay, now what are these methods? We'll learn, right? What they say is that whatever is the approach in natural sciences, what do natural scientists do? They study the natural world, the physical world, the chemical world, the biological world. They study this natural world. All right. Now, whatever methods and approach that you can use to study this natural world can also be used to study the social world. Okay, that is what positivists say. Non-positivists say that no, you cannot do that. Natural world is different, social world is different. So what methods you are using to study the natural world cannot be used to study the social world. You need different types of methods. There are three types of arguments here. We'll learn about these arguments. That is what is there in this chapter. Next, after this, we'll move on to the third chapter. So the way we are going to do, I'll explain that later, but okay. Next chapter, that is, I think, research methods. Yeah, it's called research methods and analysis. I'm just writing research methods. Now, what are these research methods? These are certain tools used by researchers to collect data, analyze this data, and interpret this data. Analyze this data and interpret this data. This is what is there in this chapter. Okay, research methods. Right here, a number of things are mentioned. First one is what is called the difference between quantitative and qualitative methods. We'll look at this. This debate between quantitative and qualitative. Okay, and as part of this debate, we'll look at what is called combining methods. Combining methods. Okay, that is how can you use both qualitative and quantitative methods together, right? Now, just to give you an idea, right? When social scientists go out in the world to find out about the world, right? They have to collect data. All researchers collect data. Some researchers collect data in the numerical form. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this, in numerical form. Some researchers collect data in verbal form. The woman walked into the class and she occupied the last bench, like this. Okay. So, if you collect data in terms of numbers, this would be quantitative data. If you collect it in terms of verbal descriptions, okay, that would be qualitative data, right? I'm just giving you a very, very basic understanding, okay, so that you don't get lost, okay? So some types of researchers collect quantitative data, some types of researchers collect qualitative, okay? And the more recent trend is that you can use both types of data together. And it is much more effective. How to do that? That is what is there here. Quantitative and qualitative methods, right? Then we are going to look at techniques of data collection. Techniques of data collection. Here, mainly, we are going to focus on certain types of techniques. First, we will study what is a questionnaire. What is a questionnaire? Then we will study what is an interview. We'll study what is a survey. Right? We'll try to understand what are these case studies. And we'll also finally try to understand what is ethnography. These are nothing but ways in which you can collect different types of data, right? So we'll learn about these techniques of data collection. Sufficient for your examination, okay? Sufficient. There are hundreds of other techniques, but this is sufficient. Yes, then finally they have clubbed some topics together. We'll understand what are variables and their relevance in research. Their relevance in different types of research. Okay, their relevance in different types of research. Then we'll also look at sampling. How many of you know what is sampling? Now, this sampling, we'll look at two types. Probability sampling and non-probability sampling. Probability sampling and non-probability sampling. Different types. Can someone tell me what is sampling? If you have finished your 10th standard, you should know what this is. Yeah. It's a method of picking the units of your study from a larger population. Okay. That is what is called sampling, right? And there are different ways in which you do sampling, right? One is probability sampling, the other one is non-probability sampling. We'll see what these two types of sampling are, all right? Then we'll look at what is hypothesis. We'll look at what is hypothesis. Okay, here we look at why a hypothesis is important, right? Second one is how to build a hypothesis, two types of things. Okay, why a hypothesis is important and how to build a hypothesis. All of you know what is a hypothesis? Yes? What is it? What is the meaning of hypothesis in all your records you have written, right? Experiment, hypothesis, like this you have written. What is the meaning of hypothesis? Not imaginary. It's not an assumption. It's not a conclusion. It's an untested relationship between two variables, right? Which is proposed by the researcher. The researcher proposes an untested relationship. And then the aim of an experiment is to test a hypothesis, isn't it? The aim of an experiment is to test a hypothesis. Okay? Then we will look at two technical concepts called reliability and validity. Reliability and validity, right? This topic mainly deals with checking the confidence in the data collected. I have collected some data, but is the data good data or bad data? All right. So how do you check it? There we use two concepts called reliability and validity of data. We'll learn about these concepts. Okay. That brings us to the end of the third chapter. Are you getting some idea as to what these things mean? A very brief, sketchy idea, huh? Are you all done? Can I erase? Then comes the fourth chapter, the most important chapter in the entire preparation. Sociological thinkers. See, who is a thinker? See, this is a very vague word, right? Sociological thinkers, right? The idea here is that in every discipline, there are some giants, isn't it? In every discipline, there are certain giants, okay? Now, in sociology too, we have a number of individuals who have conducted path-breaking research, okay? Who have conducted path-breaking research in such a way that even after 250 years later, even now we take them seriously. It is as if they have taught us something which is permanent aspects of our life. All right? So there are a number of thinkers and UPSC has picked six main thinkers. Okay, UPSC has picked six main thinkers, and the relevance of this chapter, right, is not only limited to this chapter. When you understand what these thinkers have to say, you know how to think sociologically. The way they have picked these six thinkers is that they have given you a task to think from six different dimensions. Okay, they have these thinkers, they are speaking about the same society, but they are illuminating a different dimension of society, right? So once you understand these thinkers clearly, you are expected to use the learnings from this chapter to look at each and every aspect of society. Okay? To think sociologically is nothing but to think with the ideas and views of these thinkers. All right? So that is why this chapter is very important. Okay? So here, chapter 4, the first thinker that we will deal with is what is this Emile Durkheim. He's a French sociologist. See, in your syllabus, they have mentioned some topics. But if you go through previous year's questions, you will understand that they just go beyond these topics and can ask you questions. Okay, so we'll follow a different type of format. First, we will learn about what is called as rules of sociological method. These are the four most important books that Emile Durkheim wrote. Rules of sociological method, we'll learn about this. Then we'll learn about division of labor in society. This is another book. Then we will do suicide. We study on suicide. Okay, this book is called On Suicide. All right. Then finally, we'll do his last book, that is Elementary Forms of Religious Life. Elementary Forms of Religious Life. This is what we'll do. These are the four main books that are written by Emile Durkheim, and we'll see what he has to say in these four books. All right, this will be the first thinker that we will tackle. Okay, then next we will do Karl Marx. How many of you have seen their pictures? Okay, you have seen. Most of them have very long beards, right? Karl Marx. How many of you have heard about Karl Marx before coming to this class in any context? Not outside UPSC. Outside your UPSC preparation, have you heard this name, Karl Marx? Some of you have. Okay, where have you heard? Economics as part of your graduation. Okay. Statistics also. Communist Party. Very good. That is what I wanted to hear. Socialism. In Malayalam movies. Okay. What is the movie? Kumbhalangi Nights. Okay. Right. Dear Comrade. Like that also one movie. Okay. Something of that sort. Okay. So Karl Marx is the sort of thinker who has... See, generally what happens is that there is no political party around Durkheim's name. But in whichever country you go around the world, there will be a Marxist party. There will be a Marxist party, all right? And the history of 19th and 20th centuries is in many ways the history of competition between those who believe in Marx and others. Okay? The world went to the brink of a nuclear war because of this ideological battle between Marxists and non-Marxists. Okay? What is this Cold War? The history of 20th century is nothing but the history of Cold War, right? So, in fact, Karl Marx wrote a very famous book called The Communist Manifesto, right? I went to Assam once, right? There is one place called Bodoland, okay? They speak a language called Bodo. I was stunned, okay, because there is very little literature in this Bodo language. I was stunned to know that this Karl Marx's book, Communist Manifesto, is also translated into Bodo language. Okay, that kind of reach. Okay, so Karl Marx is really not a sociologist. He's a philosopher. He's a revolutionary. He's a historian. He's an economist. He's a... In whichever social science discipline you go to, you cannot escape the specter of Karl Marx. Okay, he'll come and haunt you wherever you go. All right, so that is the thinker that we are going to do. And here we'll do, first we learn what is historical materialism. Historical materialism, okay, right? Then next we'll focus on nature of capitalism and its contradictions. And its contradictions. Third, we'll speak about what is called class struggle and transition to communism. Transition to communism, right? Then finally, we'll understand his concept of alienation. We'll understand his concept of alienation. Okay. This is how we are going to do Karl Marx. Okay. Next. Now, Marx has a frenemy. Okay. Frenemy is a friend but an enemy. Okay. And that person's name, another German philosopher, a giant of the discipline, Max Weber. Whereas Karl Marx is a revolutionary philosopher, Max Weber is an academic sociologist. Okay. Karl Marx is a revolutionary philosopher, but Max Weber is an academic sociologist. All right. Both are from Germany. And a lot of Max Weber's work is a kind of a response and critique of Karl Marx's theories and philosophy. Right. So we'll speak about in some detail about Weber's methodology. We'll speak about Weber's methodology of social sciences, right? Very important. Then second, we'll speak about what's the topic? Yes. Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism. Okay, wait 1 second. Yeah. Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism. Very, very famous and popular study. Protestant ethic and spirit of capitalism. How did capitalism emerge? He has something very interesting to say. Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism. Okay, this book basically, it is a classic, one of the classic statements or answers to the following question. That is, why is it that capitalism and modern societies emerge in Europe and not anywhere else? Have you ever wondered? Why is it that in India, we are still like somewhat stuck between tradition and modernity? There is no capitalism, no whatever. But in Western Europe, this capitalism, modernity, all these things emerge. Why? No, not due to resources. Okay. In fact, Weber tells us in this book that at the time when capitalism emerged in Europe, China and India were far more richer than all the European countries put together. Then why is it that capitalism emerged in Europe and not in any of these other countries? Don't try to answer. Okay? It's beyond you to answer this question at this stage. Okay, I'm just telling you that this is the question that we are going to ask ourselves. Right? Why did it emerge in Europe? We have something very interesting to say. All right. Then we will talk about this Weber's concept of rationalization. Of social action. Okay, rationalization of social action, right? What is this rationalization of social action and what is called this bureaucracy? Bureaucracy as a consequence of rationalization of social action. Okay, so we'll try to understand what is bureaucracy. Okay, many of you, all of you here want to become part of bureaucracy. So let us try to clearly understand what exactly is this bureaucracy. What does it do? Okay, so this is what we are going to learn here, right? Let me see if there's anything else. Yeah, this is what we'll learn in Max Weber, right? So by the time, see these three thinkers, right? Emil Durkheim, Max Weber, and Karl Marx are called classical sociological thinkers. They are called classical sociological thinkers, right? That is, they laid the foundation of the sociological thinking, right? So by the time you are done with these three thinkers, you have some idea as to what sociologists do, okay? How is this discipline of sociology actually different? What is the job of a sociologist? You will be able to understand something by the time we finish these three thinkers. Then we'll fast forward and move to the 1930s and 1940s, where we are going to start talking about another popular thinker called Talcott Parsons. Talcott Parsons. Okay. Under Talcott Parsons, two things we are going to understand. One is what is called voluntaristic theory of action. Voluntaristic theory of action. The second one is what is called Talcott Parsons' systems theory. Now, this person, Talcott Parsons, see, sometimes what happens is that suddenly a new actor, a hero, he emerges on the scene. 1, 2, 3, 4 hit movies. Okay, everybody is saying that he's so great. But suddenly after some time, goes away, right? It's like suddenly all the movie, any movie hero you can think of like this. Any movie hero you can think of like this. No, you don't watch movies, right? Okay. In cricket, he's like Vinod Kambli. Okay. For some time, everybody thinks that he's going to be the greatest person ever, but later everybody forgets. Okay. So Talcott Parsons is like that. Between 1930 and 1960, there was no difference between sociological theory and Parsonian sociology. What Parsons said was sociology. Okay. But later, this entire theory got debunked. Okay, we'll learn what did this person have to say. All right, we'll learn about this person. Then his student, Robert Merton. This is UPSC's favorite person, okay, Robert Merton. Robert Merton. Under this, the first thing that you have to learn about is what is this Robert Merton's restatement of functionalist paradigm. Restatement of functionalist paradigm. All right. Now what this is, you will understand in due course of time, right? Then you will understand Robert Merton's theory of deviance. Theory of deviance. And you will also understand what is this reference group theory. Reference group theory. All right. Reference group theory. You will understand this, these three topics. Okay. And finally, we'll do George Herbert Mead. Here, we'll try to understand, I'll just put it in one simple line, how mind, society, and identity. Are interrelated. How mind, society, and identity are interrelated. This is the main thing that we have to understand in George Herbert. Okay. The fifth chapter will do as it is, whatever is given in the syllabus. Okay. Just you can write that down. Okay. Do you want to write down all the concepts that we'll do in fifth chapter? Just write down. It's as it is, whatever is given in the syllabus. The chapter is called Stratification and Mobility. It's called Stratification and Mobility. See, just for your basic understanding, right? In our society, there is inequality, right? And the inequality is between groups. And these groups can be arranged as if they are in a ladder. Okay, suppose this is the entire society. Okay, there is the bottommost group. On top, there is a group. On top, there is a group. On top, there is a group. Like this, you can arrange them. Okay, these are what are called social strata. Strata means a layer, right? These are what are called social strata. Okay. Stratification refers to the division of society into unequal groups. Division of society into unequal groups, right? Now, suppose there is an individual here. Okay. He has worked very hard and he's moved from this layer, this strata to this strata. And again, from this strata to this strata. We would say that this individual is attaining social mobility. That is the meaning of mobility. Are you all able to follow? Right? Or tired already? No, right? It means that if an individual is bettering his situation, either in this top direction or bottom direction, if the movement is in any way, then you would say that there is social mobility. Now, in some types of societies, inequalities are such that if you are born in this bottommost strata, there is no way that you can move up. There is no way that you can move up. What? Can you give me an example? Varna system, right? The caste system is a type of system. Even if you become a president of India, you are still India's Dalit president. Okay, it is like that. Okay, there is no opportunity to move from one strata to another strata, right? So this type of systems where you cannot move from one strata to another strata is called a closed system. A closed system where you cannot move. If you can move, it is called as an open system. All right. So now in stratification and mobility, we are going to understand how societies are divided into unequal groups, right? What is the nature of closed stratification? What is the nature of open stratification? And what are the chances of mobility? What are the chances of mobility of moving from one group to another group? Okay. One of the greatest motivations behind people coming and going through all this torture, right, of UPSC examination is this only, social mobility. You want to better your situation. You want to better your situation, right? That is the idea. So we'll learn about these concepts, okay? So just write down the topics that we'll learn are inequality, equality, 1, 2, inequality, 3, hierarchy, 4, exclusion, 5, poverty versus deprivation, right? Like this, okay? Poverty versus deprivation. Poverty versus deprivation. Okay. Then we'll learn about social stratification. Okay. Then we learn about the concept of class. Next, concept of status. Concept of gender. Concept of gender. Then we'll also learn about ethnicity and race. Ethnicity. Ethnicity and race. Okay, how ethnicity and race can lead to inequalities in society, right? That is what we are going to learn. Then we are also going to learn about open systems and closed systems. Open systems and closed systems. Then we are also going to learn about, is there a confusion, sir? You? No. We are going to learn about open systems and closed systems. Then we are going to learn about types of mobility in open and closed systems. Types of mobility in open and closed systems. Types of mobility in open and closed systems, right? Then we are also going to learn about sources and causes of mobility. Sources and causes of mobility. Sources and causes of mobility, right? And finally, we are also going to learn about certain theories of social stratification. Theories of social stratification. We're going to learn about theories of social stratification, right? Here, first we are going to learn about what is called the functionalist theory. And when we do the functionalist theory, we will focus on the work of scholars by name Wilbert E. Moore. Font size. Functionalist school. You don't need the names of scholars now. I'll explain when I explain. Okay. We'll do the functionalist school. Then we are going to do the Marxist school. Finally, we'll also deal with the Weberian notion of stratification. All right. So this is what is there in your fifth chapter. Can someone quickly go to the office and get me a marker, please? Someone at the back. Can I erase this? What is the impression that you are getting by looking at what you have to study? You think it's manageable somewhat or too many topics? Huh? It is scary. Okay. So that's what it is. Whatever you have to learn in 3 years, you have to learn in 16 weeks. So it is scary. Okay, so your feelings are accurate at least. Right. The next one is a somewhat simple and smaller chapter called Work and Economic Life. Okay, this is the chapter. Here, mainly our focus is on understanding how production, distribution, and consumption occur in different types of societies. Okay, because every society, in order to survive and sustain, it must produce something. It must produce something, and whatever has been produced needs to be distributed among the people, whether equally or unequally. Then it people have to have the ability to buy and consume certain things, right? So in different types of societies, these processes are different. Okay, so that is what we'll learn in the first subtopic, that is called social organization of work in different types of societies. Social organization of work in different types of societies. Okay, and here we divide these different types of societies into the slave society, the feudal society, and the capitalist society. Slave society, feudal society, and capitalist society. Okay, you have to divide this into these three types of society. We'll stop the class now. We'll continue. We'll do this syllabus mapping tomorrow also. We'll finish it for paper two as well. Okay. See, this may be somewhat boring for you in the very first two classes, but this is very, very important. You'll realize the importance of this exercise when you finish writing your prelims exam. Do you know what you need to know or not? Okay, how are you going to check? Only through this syllabus mapping you have to check. Okay, so we'll continue doing this tomorrow as well, and we'll start with the first chapter on Monday. Okay, that is what we'll do. So the sense I'm getting is that all of you will be there on Monday also, right? Isn't that right? So have you all joined this Telegram group? Okay, you have to join a Telegram group, okay, because all the material, PDF copies, everything will be sent in that group. And suppose if there is cancellation of class or if there is an extra class, all such information will be on this group. Okay,